So if you think of the core emotions, one of the things Violet would do is she would take an instrument and she would have her client have an instrument, and you would, let's say, work on anger.
Right.
And so Violet would join her client in expressing anger through the instrument, or happiness, or fear, or sadness. And so we thought we would model that once for each of the emotions, and then have you just practice in breakout rooms. So do you want to? We could just do a couple, and then the people in breakout rooms could also pick a couple just to practice and have fun with it.
I mean, Violet used to say that anger gets a bad press and it's the most misunderstood of emotions. So should we work with anger and just show how we can make angry sounds using our instruments, including our
Sure.
voices?
Sure. So, in this case, this would be a way to do in dyads. So, would anyone be open to working with John on anger?
Okay, so shall I go first, Alessandro, or do you want to go first?
And as I understood, if you start, then I join you, no?
Yes,
And then
yes.
we express together. Yeah.
Okay.
So please,
So.
you. Yeah.
Oh, that's a good one. So, do people get the idea from that? It's just like a musical conversation. You do your thing, your partner does her thing or his thing, and then we find a way of maybe copying or just seeing how we want to play together, like Alessandra and I were doing just then.
Alessandra, anything about how that was?
Yeah, it was really interesting because I really quickly I started to feel funny, you know, to laugh, and so it's really interesting how, and we know about the model, how is really related to be fun, to have fun and express aggressivity. Yeah.
It reminds me, some of you may have seen one of the early videos that Violet did with Abram, a boy and his anger. And at the end, she has a bataka fight, a fight with encounter bats. So it's both a fight and it's clearly fun as well. So yes, there's a crossover, I think. And when we can express anger safely, like you and I could, actually, it's a relief and it starts to become enjoyable.
Yeah, and even I personally have a problem with anger. I really have problem to express it. So it was really, really helpful for me today.
Expressed it pretty well. That's great.
Well, if you're gonna feel safe with anyone, it would be John for sure. I could get really mad with you, John, also. So not at you, but with you. So, thank you both for showing that. So, you can, we're going to give you about 10 minutes in breakout rooms. And the emotions are sad, mad, glad, and scared. And maybe you're going to focus more on one, or you'll try all four just briefly. How was the working with emotions and music?
I thought it was wonderful, because I felt like before you knew it, you were connecting with your own emotions, your own experience of each emotion in your week or whatever experience came up. I thought it was really wonderful to express it without having to cognitively explain it. That's what I felt was amazing.
I love that. Thank you. Welcome back. Any thoughts, any other thoughts about what this was like?
It was interesting because Maya and I couldn't get the sound to work with the instruments, and so we just used our voices and facial expression. It was fascinating. We had a lot of fun.
It calls on some creativity, resilience, problem solving, all of that. Yes.
Huge facial movement.
Oh, well, I'm glad you worked it out.
And it's a great thing we can do also in working in pairs with a client, encouraging, make a face and see if they can get the emotion, and then you swap over. The ability to read each other's faces can be a real skill, and it's something some of the kids that I work with often don't always get right, so it's useful. What emotion have I got now?
And whether you're working in groups or working with pairs, one of the things I've noticed is technology aside, again, that's a part of this experience for sure. We know that. And it's such a great way to work on group process. So who starts? Who one of you mentioned the word shy, who's a little shy in the group and wants to make sure that they don't dominate or offend anyone, and who won't let it end, and who doesn't mind dominating with a really loud sound. And so often however they are in a group with musical instruments, let's say, it might say something about who they are in other settings as well, and it's a way to work on that. So we wanted to, there's more to do with music, but we wanted to give you a just an idea of how Violet used it, how we thought about how to use it with Zoom, and include you in this process. Anything we didn't think of that people use?
And just to add to that, you don't like using an instrument yourself, or you haven't got one to hand, but you have a phone with you. Using a playlist can be really useful as an accompaniment to drawing work or working with clay or any kind of imaginal work if you've got the right kind of music. I try and just record a few things so that I've got something I can go to that could be useful if somebody wants to work on loss or a dream or a celebration or whatever. And we might as well make use of the technologies. We're all carrying it around with us.
I just wanted to say that Ivan and I work together, and we are just starting to kind of hone in towards the end about there were certain emotions that when we played them, we ended up feeling more connected and probably some less connected. And it's not an area that I've done a lot of work with kids in terms of just speculating about which are the emotions that lead to more connectivity. and which are the emotions that are a little bit more insular or separate feeling. And Ivan and I were just starting to sort of talk about that. And I think GLAAD made us kind of connected in a more vibrant way.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, very good. Well,
can I add something, Karen?
Of course.
Yeah, I'm thinking about just what happens actually in my office with instruments. And a lot of times it's just very spontaneous. Like in the corner of my office, there's a basket of instruments and then a couple of drums. And a couple of the kids I work with, sometimes as they're leaving, they'll go over and bang on the drums a little bit, like almost like a goodbye, you know, to kind of get their last bit of aggressive energy out or joy, or like it's often kind of a closing spontaneous ritual. And I'm thinking that just sort of diagnostically, some of the kids I work with who have ADHD really hyper focus in a lovely way with the instruments, where we'll just get on the floor and they can really, you know, stay with me in contact, and sometimes not using much language with, you know, with our voices, you know, for like sometimes like 20 or 30 minutes. So much longer than some of the other activities that we tend to kind of jump from one thing to the next thing, which, you know, I always think of Violet talking about, you know, if the kids are moving around a lot, you just move with them. And there's something about, even without my suggesting it, that certain kids really gravitate towards these baskets of things. And I guess another sort of piece about just our international focus, a lot of my instruments have come from other countries where I've been, and they're very different from, you know, things that a lot of the, you know, what kids here have been exposed to. So it's a kind of a neat opportunity too, to, because they'll ask me, what is this? Where did you get this? And I have a map, you know, then sometimes we'll talk about that. And so it's cool.
I find kids who have difficulty speaking or who are shy often will gravitate to a drum. I spend a lot of work with some people with who are selectively mute, and it took a long time for them to find their voice, but it's as though the drum, whatever, from whatever country, often kind of offers that sort of sound back. It's rather wonderful. And you're reminding me, Lynn, that instruments from so many countries and cultures, including our own, wherever that may be, and our voices, we can't play them without being embodied. You know, they need breath, they need holding, grasping, striking. So all these things that we sometimes take for granted, it's all part of learning to be more embodied ourselves. And that's something I think we celebrate really in this, when everything is so small and we learn to tap very, very gently on things. It's great to have experiences perhaps of using big motor movements or other types of movement that we might not use so much.
Yeah. Without the instruments.
Yeah.
And I'll just say one last thing too, that I don't usually give homework, and I almost never let a child take something from my office, but I do have sort of these very inexpensive plastic harmonicas that I give them out quite regularly, just in terms of aggressive energy work or just using the breath, or kids who maybe are getting into trouble acting out a bit at home, or you know, just having, you know, almost like something to have on your anger list of that you can, you know, make quite a lot of noise and breathe and focus with a little plastic harmonica, that's not maybe quite as disruptive for the rest of the family as some other thing.
No recorders.
Or drums or symbols.
And even though those are very satisfying.
I have a thought I'd like to share, kind of in process with. So me and my partner, we were, I think, moving through the experience, definitely brought up some thoughts and feelings, and we were also reflecting on the first exercise with the six participants, and it stirred up this like theoretical image of working with a family and maybe using, you know, that little jam session to see like what is their dynamic in the family, and how you know, like moving from chaos, and maybe, you know, even hearing like maybe different expectations that people were having, like in the family, of what they want the sound to sound like, but then what it actually is, and having a conversation around that, and having this like tangible of like, oh, this is what it feels like in the family at different moments, but also having the emotional distance of like the music to talk about those dynamics. So yeah, I was just having this like conceptual thought around that.
Mm-hmm. Judy, if you can get hold of a copy of the International Gestalt Journal 2009, mm-hmm. I wrote an article in that. That was the Festschrift to Violet, edited by Felicia Carroll. And one of the examples in there, I describe working with a family who talk over each other and continually interrupt each other. And using music, because this family just ate therapist for breakfast, you know, and was too verbal. You had to act as a policeman and slow them down and bring them in. And if you can learn to do that, then actually there's some chance that they might get to listen to each other and even enjoy that. And that's what happened in that case. So have a look at that, or email me and I'll send you a copy of the...
Oh my gosh, yes. Can I would love to get the title of that article that you wrote.
It's called I Got Rhythm.
I've Got Rhythm.
Yeah, okay. Music Making, I think, the Oakland Away with Children and Adolescents, something like that.
It's also available, I'm pretty sure, at the Vsauce store, that journal.
Oh.
And it has John's article and others. And so those of you, Judy and others, might be interested in it. If you go to the Vsauce store. And I'm so glad that you thought about other clinical applications of what we're doing. That's sort of our intent, of besides having fun. I'm reading through Audible Adam Grant's Hidden Potential, I think is the name of the book. And he talks about playful learning and all the research about how play and learning, like it's incredibly robust amount of literature that everyone, all ages, learn better when there's play associated with learning. And I'm thinking, oh, well, I certainly appreciate everything he's saying. And I think, you know, maybe that's why I enjoy this work so much, both participating and leading the training. So hoping that this play that we've done together has been also an opportunity to learn. It always is for me. Okay, so we have a few videos to close with, and Lynn has a great one.
So I had this up, I put our store in the chat.
Oh, great.
And then this link is there, and when the one that John was speaking of was this one to the right, this kind of yellowish cover that says International Gestalt Journal, that's there. And I do not post very much on Facebook, but I came across this the other day and I just love it. I don't know if I can get this big enough, but I got a big kick out of it.
I the girls, you call the girls.
Okay. It seemed to fit.
I really think it does. I think it fits in so many ways because I saw it when you posted it and then we've showed it a couple times. And I feel like it's what we try to do when we're making contact, which is be inviting, be silly, right? And leave space for the other person to join us and have no worries if they do or they don't, because we're having fun. And then in fact, that friend did join in. I loved it.
Yeah, with a little trepidation, but
a little trepidation.
Didn't take her long.
It didn't, and that's how it can work. It can work that way, you know?